Well, it's not that hard to live another 14 years on average. If you just do the right things, which is don't become obese, do some exercise, eat good food. What are the other ones? I think it's get sleep and don't stress, the basic stuff. That in itself will give you 14 years. It's been calculated, you know, bad luck notwithstanding. But you can go beyond that. That's just the minimal. If I could recommend one thing for people to try, it would be to eat less often. You know, I've totally changed my life around this. So has my father, who's 81, without any medical issues at all. We now eat one meal a day. I might have a bit of lunch, but not much. And the rest is just warm drinks, which I love anyway. There are some really good experiments that show in many different species, and we've known this for 80 years, that reducing the amount of calorie intake, particularly if you restrict it during certain times of the day, it's beneficial. One of the best experiments I could point to, or it's a set of experiments, is by Rafael DiCarbo at the NIA, which is the National Institute on Aging in Bethesda. And he did a very interesting set of experiments in mice, admittedly, but it was really telling. He was trying to figure out what are the differences between diets, and you can give mice more calories in the form of fat or protein or carbohydrate. And he did all those combinations, 10,000 mice. But he did something also interesting, which was fed the mice either all during the night when they typically eat, called ad libitum feeding, or only for a little window during the day, or during the night, I should say. And the mice ate almost the same amount of food, because you can imagine if you're a hungry mouse, you're going to gobble it down really quickly within that hour of feeding. The ones that lived longer were the ones that had the restricted, time-restricted feeding. It didn't matter what they were eating. So what that tells me, most likely, and there's epidemiological evidence this is true in humans, that it's not as important about what you eat. You know, of course, you can't eat a terribly horrible diet and expect to live longer, but within reason, it's more important when and how often you eat. Well, like all science, I mean, seriously, I'm standing on the shoulder of giants. There are giants that figured out that you can reset the age of somatic adult cells to be zero. So John Gordon and Shinya Yamanaka did those experiments in tadpoles and in skin cells, respectively, and won the Nobel Prize deservedly in, was it 2012, I think? So that was part of the initiative of reversing aging. But we needed to do that. We needed to reset the age of cells, not to zero, but by 50 or 75% without causing the cells to become tumors. Mm-hmm. And that was the challenge. We spent about 3 years trying different genetic combinations, trying genes that come on in embryos, trying genes that are helpful to cancers but not causing cancer, and finally hit upon a three-gene combination that resets the age of the cell by about 75%. And you might say, well, how do you know how old a cell is? Well, we actually now have a very accurate way of measuring the age of a cell or of the body. Some people call it the Horvath clock. It's also known as the DNA methylation clock. We can read the chemicals that change over time that are on the DNA, called methyls, and that gives us a really accurate measure of age. And so we could now take those mice that had restored vision and truly ask, are those cells just acting young, or are they literally young? And the answer was, they are literally young again. And that was the first discovery that in a living organism, you could safely reprogram and reset the age of the body. How soon is this available to humans? Well, we're working towards doing our first clinical trial in the next couple of years. We've already got 2 years of work under our belt there.
Wow.
Yeah. But what about other parts of the body? I think that it's going to be possible to reset most parts of the body. The question is, you know, the safety issue, of course, but my lab has now had some early results resetting other parts of the body. Muscle is looking promising. We've got other labs doing the brain. Actually, we've got some early results with Alzheimer's disease and old age dementia. Hot area right now. Going back when I started my first company, 2004, it was crazy to think that you could develop a medicine that would tackle the root causes of aging or slow it down. And people didn't even understand how to think about it, let alone build companies out of it. I think we showed that it was possible. And we're now in a world actually where longevity research and longevity development of drugs, development of longevity drugs, is one of the hottest areas in biotechnology. You know, I sit in the center of a tornado of activity, and I see that it's really gone almost vertical in a graph of interest of investors. I'm part of a group actually that recently said we were going to invest in a company related to longevity. We haven't picked out which company yet. And there was $1 billion of interest. So this is, we're in it's a zeitgeist. In other words, that I think the science has reached a point where Wall Street and hopefully Main Street increasingly has realized that the science has come of age and that we can truly develop medicines that will use this knowledge, not only to treat aging, but to treat the effects of aging. And actually 85% of all suffering on the planet, including most major diseases, are due to aging. We're in denial that aging is not important, but actually it's far more important for lung cancer than smoking is, for example, by at least an order of magnitude. So this is a major issue, but I'm optimistic now that we've seemingly turned a corner, similar to, I use the Wright brothers as a good example. And, you know, we're now in the 1920s, where people have seen that the Wright flyer works, and there's a lot of interest in building, you know, eventually a Boeing 747.
Adopting that.
Would I take resveratrol? Well, I do still take resveratrol. I take a teaspoonful of it every morning. I take it with a tiny bit of yogurt just because it needs to dissolve. It's like brick dust, otherwise it doesn't dissolve. And I've been doing that since my 30s, and I'm still alive. We don't know if it's going to make me live longer. You know, I'm not doing this to try and live forever. I don't really worry about that. But I am very curious, and I do like to learn things quickly. My father's been on resveratrol for the same amount of time, and as I mentioned, he's 81 and is as fit or fitter than I am. But I don't recommend supplements. I'm not an MD, and we don't know if these are going to work. But there is a lot of evidence, I would say, in animal studies that resveratrol is relatively benign, and also can be beneficial to your metabolism and protecting the organs. So I continue to take it until I see evidence that it could be dangerous. And I haven't seen anything like that in 20 years. I do take another molecule that's fairly prominent in the media, which is called an NAD booster. You can buy these, they're called either NR or NMN. I certainly don't sell anything at all. I don't promote anything, but I find that a lot of people are interested in it. So I'm mentioning it tonight. NAD boosters came out of research out of my lab as well as Lenny Gorenti's. We discovered that the sirtuin enzymes are controlled by the level of NAD. This is a molecule that our bodies make for metabolic reactions, but also control the sirtuin's activity. And when you're hungry, if you're a yeast cell or a human, your levels of NAD will rise. But as you get older, it declines. And so what we're trying to do is to artificially boost up the levels of NAD in the body. And that's why I take the molecule called NMN, which is a precursor to NAD. Interestingly, and what's very rarely recognized, is that one of the companies that I co-founded, called Metro Biotech, has been doing clinical trials in people for over 2 years now with an NAD boosting molecule that is related to NMN, and found, you know, really great results so far. I'm not at liberty to say what they are yet, but you know, I'm still taking NMN, having seen all the data. But I don't want anyone to get the impression that I'm a cowboy who's just experimenting on himself. It's not that, you know, I only take very calculated, you know, barely risks, but I also at the same time do clinical trials on these molecules to try and rapidly find out, A, are they safe, and B, are they effective?